So, hi everyone. Welcome to the Band with Kaleidoscope Ears podcast. And tonight we're not going to be analyzing songs. And I have with me, as usual, James Corbett of the Corbett Report, and special guest Matt Williamson from Pop Goes the Sixties. And we're going to talk about Beatles tonight, but kind of from a different viewpoint. We're going to talk about the effect the Beatles had on their fans. So just to get started, I guess, to get the ball rolling, since the three of us are big fans of the Beatles, why don't we each kind of say how we got into becoming Beatles fans? We're representing almost three different generations of people here. So should be interesting to see how that pans out. So Matt, would you like to begin?
I'd be delighted. Thanks for having me on, Vinny.
Great pleasure.
Yeah, I started listening to music at a very young age. So I was spinning records at the age of two. And one of the things, my background, my professional life, I'm a designer and I'm in marketing. So at a very young age, not only did I love listening to music, but I loved the shape of the 45 singles and I loved the labels. So when I moved to the house I grew up in at the age of three, my neighbor, who was my age, he had seven older brothers and sisters, and they had tons of records. So that's how I started listening to, it was essentially all 60s music. And there were three Beatle 45s in the collection there. They had Thank You Girl and Do You Want to Know a Secret on the Black VJ label. And the other two were on the Apple label. It was Come Together Something and Hey Jude Revolution. So that's how I got started with those three singles, really, with the Beatles.
Wow, what a span between eras.
And the thing is I couldn't read at the time. So, but it took a couple years before I realized, oh, these are by the same band. And there's a lot of, those Apple labels, I from a young age, I thought that was just, I still think that's the greatest label ever. And so that's what got me started in the 60s music. My parents had music around and then I went from there.
Awesome. Just kind of as a quick side note, I just wanted to mention that I really love your podcast because it's not just because you hit on the Beatles and talk about Beatles, but you're talking about 60s music as a whole. And I've been saying for a long, long time that this music needs to be looked into very seriously because some of the compositions of that era are truly remarkable, on the level of high art. And
Yeah, I agree with you. There is a video topic in that, I assure you.
Yeah. Or a whole channel.
Yeah, that's true, yeah.
Sorry, can I just butt in? Matt, you're a designer, so I assume you designed all the logo and graphics and everything for your
team. Yeah, awesome. Yes. Yeah,
really good.
Thank you.
Hmm. All right, so James, let's hear your story of how you got into the Beatles. What was it?
Sure. Well, I'm the youngin' in the crowd, so it is actually increasingly a question, and perhaps one that'll come up in this conversation, or perhaps should come up in the future. How do people these days become Beatles fans? Because it's going to be a very different process. But in my era, I am late Gen X, not millennial. Don't call me a millennial, but almost a millennial. And so I grew up with the Beatles because my parents are from England. I was born and raised in Canada, but my parents are English. So they had the original Parlophone records that we grew up with. And, when we went on family trips or whatever, that the parents would put on the Beatles in the car. So I was very familiar with their oeuvre from a very young age. But of course, that was my parents' music. How uncool is that, right? No kid wants to grow up thinking that their parents' music is cool. So it wasn't until 95, right, when the anthology started to air. And it was one of those things where I knew my parents will be interested in this. I should tape it for them. But this was the era where when you're taping something on your VCR, you literally can't watch anything else. So I sat down and thought, I'll watch it. Why not? And it was interesting. The first hour of that anthology that aired on CBS or whatever it was at that time, I remember watching that and just being captivated by the story itself, that was, I think, what originally sort of hooked me into it, was that regardless of whatever you think about their music, just the story of this pop cultural phenomenon that took place in the 60s is just so overwhelming, and trying to frame it and put it into some sort of perspective, it really struck me at that time. And so I started to get drawn into the story. And from that, I remember watching the anthology and then becoming, of course, more interested in these old records that are kicking around in my parents' collection, and giving Revolver a spin and going, oh, wow, this is actually really quite good. I didn't know it was, oh, okay. And that's basically what drew me in. So it wasn't until the mid-90s, in my high school years, late teenage years, that I started to get into it.
Huh. I could see why you'd be drawn in by the story. You being a researcher and that whole thing, it's kind of like part and parcel to that, you know, finding the little factoids and pieces and the things that made the story happen. Yeah, I get that. As for me, well, I was there. And, you know, I was just a little boy. I had an older sister, and we're hearing news of this British band. And I probably heard, you know, I Want to Hold Your Hand on the radio once or twice, tinny AM radio. And then I remember the moment they played at Ed Sullivan Theater, at the Ed Sullivan Show. And my sister had gotten her little teeny bopper friends. I have an older sister. And they were screaming the whole time that they're watching the TV. It was really remarkable. And I'm watching this. And I saw the glitz first. That's what I really saw. It's like, oh, these guys are so cool. Because as dorky as they look today, you know, that those early days when we look back, in those days, they were just super cool with the Beatle boots and the collarless suits and all this. So the first thing I thought was, wow, the girls are screaming after them. They look super cool. I want to be that. And that's actually what so many musicians will talk, so many famous musicians will say, that was the moment that turned me on to being a musician. But it took years for me to really, I had a couple of friends that I was in a band with, and we did Beatles covers and stuff like that. And it was still this feeling of, well, the coolness of the Beatles. But over time, we began to see the brilliance, the absolute brilliance that were the Beatles. And so the story continues, you know.
Well, let me add to that, actually, because I can give you the secondhand story of my father, who told me about when he first encountered the Beatles. He, at that time, had moved from England to Australia with his family. So he was in Australia when Beatlemania hit. And I guess it probably hit in Australia 63, probably, before America, right? So I think the breakthrough hit in Australia was She Loves You. And I remember my dad telling me the story that they were out playing at the local swimming pool. And they've got the radio over the, you know, the speaker system or whatever, just playing songs or whatever. And She Loves You came on, and just instantly my father and everyone else was like, what is this? It sounded like from a different planet or something. They'd never heard anything like it. And just instantly everyone knew, oh, this is the new thing. And I've read a lot of stories, anecdotes of people like that online. And I can certainly understand it, because I wasn't there, but it certainly does seem like this was a new phenomenon that was happening based around that.
Yeah, I think some of us take for granted that nothing sounded like that before the Beatles. It took me, I was in college when I was a similar story, James, where it was Joe Walsh was talking about the Beatles. No, it was Sting. Sting was in they were swimming at the local swimming hole. And Love Me Do came on the radio, and they were all in the locker room. And the harmonica is like echoing through the whole thing. Everybody's just playing using their towels, playing guitars. And it finally hit me that nothing sounded like that before that moment. And having grown up, you know, after the Beatles really broke up, I didn't really get that feeling at all, which is a kind of a shame.
Yeah. I think Allen Ginsberg had the story of being in a cafe in New York in 1964 or whatever, when I Want to Hold Your Hand came on the radio, and he heard it for the first time, and he just got up and started spontaneously dancing to it, because it was just so...
That sounds like Allen.
Yeah.
What was the phrase you just used, James? From another world, was that it?
Yeah, another like planet or something, yeah.
Yeah, it's funny because I just a minor bit of research, I was looking at like what celebrities say about the Beatles, and I have this page of quotes. Chrissy Hynde, the Pretenders, I remember exactly where I was sitting. It was amazing. It was like the axis shifted. It was kind of like an alien invasion. So, out of this world.
Yeah.
Anyway, so we're going to discuss, let's talk about the fans. I mean, the whole point is, at least to my mind, is that, first of all, there are different kinds of fans. I'm sure we all know that. And different reasons why these fans became fans. So, and I also believe that this fandom changes over the years, like the reasons why people become Beatles fans from the early days on up till contemporary times. So if we go back to early days, I would say, number one, it was the girls first that started the whole ball rolling as far as the fandom, because they were so tremendously overwhelmed by them. And I think that in turn caught the guys on. I remember in an anthology, they were asking some kids, the girls, you know, they put a mic to a girl's face and they said, "Why do you like, oh, they're so cute. They're so cool. The Beatles are just really cool." And then they gave the mic to a young boy, a teenage boy. And he said, "Well," he goes, "you know, I think their music is really intelligent." So there's the male female, you know, difference.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, clearly, I would say clearly, again, I wasn't there, but I think that's the way they were marketed. It's interesting to me, actually, to go back to the early coverage and the early interviews and things. And it was always about the hair. That was the only thing that people were interested in noting or talking about. That was the iconic thing, especially there in 64. As it broke out in America, it was about the hair. It was the hair.
Yeah,
and that's ridiculous in retrospect, but it's part of what made their image, I guess.
That seemed to be more important than the music, really. I mean, as far as the establishment was concerned, I mean, that was a big deal to have hair like that. And I just was reading, the next video I'm working on are the Rascals. And they got some real grief in Florida or in the southern states, like in 66. And it's just, it boggles the mind to think that hair that was just a couple inches longer than normal would throw people that off. But it did.
Yeah, well, you know, you're talking about the faction of anti-fans that were happening, it was happening at the same time. The older generations were reacting badly against it. And the image of the all-American boy was the buzz cut.
Well, actually, before we started rolling, we were talking about Lewison's extended edition that we both have sitting on our bookshelf here. And one of the things that really struck me when I was reading that was the contextualization of the music scene in the 50s, early 60s, from which the Beatles emerged. And it really gave me the sense, a visceral sense, that rock and roll was, the original wave, late 50s, was just another in a seemingly endless iteration of, here's the new fad. It's rock and roll, it's the twist, it's whatever. The next fad is coming, just wait 9 months and there'll be something else. And that was the pattern. So when the Beatles emerged as a rock and roll band from England, that was regurgitated, like we're going back to the previous trend, like what's going on here? I can understand certainly why no one would have taken this seriously musically at first. This isn't even a trend. This was the last trend. Like, this is ridiculous. So I can see why people were so blindsided by it, because I don't think people expected this rock and roll to become what it became. We see it now, obviously, from the other side. But at that time, it was literally just a fad.
Yeah, and precisely that's because, and I was going to say that the cynicism that the Beatles met when it came to reviewers and critics that were saying, well, this fad will be over soon, or they're asking, when do you think the Beatles will, when will this all end, you know, that sort of thing. So there was that.
And that was, again, that was another very commonly repeated question to them in the early years, right? How, you know, mm-hmm. What will you do in a year when nobody's listening to your music anymore? Kind of. Yeah. But that actually speaks to a sort of one of the interesting parts of the historiography of Beatles fandom, if that's what we're looking at, is the very visceral difference between the actual experience, the way that people were experiencing it in that moment, versus what we now 50 years later, looking back with all of the contextualization of essentially the entire industry that the Beatles helped to spearhead there, and the pioneering of what we understand as an entire musical art form was basically born in that moment. So people experiencing it in that moment wouldn't have any of that context to be able to understand that. So obviously the perception of it as it's happening in the experience is going to be very different than coming along afterwards and trying to relive it, which is one of the reasons why I think Lewison's work is so valuable, because he's writing it in the perspective of that moment without jumping ahead and saying, you know, this is what will happen 30 years from later, or, you know, this is the perspective from 2010 or whatever. No. He's writing it in that moment of, these are just boys who are playing this musical fad that who knows what's going to happen. And that's the only way we can properly, I think, contextualize it. But then again, I'm saying this to someone who was actually there as it was happening, so you probably have a better perspective on that.
Well, I was just a little boy, but, you know, I was going to say that one thing, I think that when people research the Beatles for real, one of the astonishing things to most people is the incredible transition they went through from the beginning to the end, how much they changed so quickly, and all of the records pretty much, you know, showed that. I recall, like, when they began to head into the psychedelic thing, already there was talk about hippies, and there were whispers about this LSD stuff being very dangerous. And being a little boy, you know, I heard about that LSD distorts reality and stuff. And so when I heard Strawberry Fields for the first time, it scared me. It literally scared me. But it was a weird thing, because at the same time, it was the Beatles. So I still love them. One of the comments I think I once made with you, James, is Paul was always the happy, kind of hopeful, positive one. And so on the heels of Strawberry Fields, you get Penny Lane, which is this jaunty little song. And it's almost as if Paul is saying, yeah, things are getting weird, but I'm still here. We're still having fun. Don't worry about it.
You know? I can be weird in a happy way.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, the fans... Rock and roll was only about 8 years old when the Beatles hit the shores of America. And 8 years is like nothing. So if you think from those, you know, the early Elvis stuff to when he went in the service, and then really from like 59 to 63, at least in America, you had this kind of rock music that was a Hollywood byproduct, you know, and then the Beatles hit. And I think they just, the industry, I mean, they didn't really get a hold of the industry. The industry didn't get a hold of the bands completely again until the mid 80s. That's how I see it. And that was with the dawn of video, when they were able to retake control. Because really, from the Beatles up through the mid 80s, it's really the artists that were driving everything. And it was the record companies that were just floundering just to follow along and try to make as much money as they could doing whatever they could. But it was really the artists that were in control and they were leading everything, which I think was that's why I think, Vinny, that area is considered so artistic, because they were the ones leading it, not like today where you've got, you don't have the artists really leading anything. It's the big conglomerates that are recreating music and fabricating it, so.
Yeah, no, that's an incredibly important point. The structure of the industry itself and how that was changed by the Beatles. And then, as you say, this is sort of the attempt to regain the control. Of course, it's always a give and take, and there's always, I'm sure the labels always have their ways of making money from their product. But I think you're right. There was, in an industry where you have some version of some sort of Tin Pan Alley writers, and then you have the performing fleas who perform those songs, there's a lot more control that you can have, direct control over the direction of that industry, when suddenly now everybody's in their home writing their own songs and all of this incredible artistic stuff is happening now. And I mean that does raise questions about the industry now, because what is the music industry now? I mean, yeah, I guess the major labels and stuff still exist, but albums don't really exist. Not really. I mean, they're there, but no one listens to albums. They stream songs independently. And it's possible for TikTokers and YouTubers to become incredible celebrities spontaneously or organically in some way. I mean, a Jacob Collier did not arise from the music industry in the normal way, or people like that. So, I mean, there's some interesting things going on, but actually that raises a point that I was thinking about with regards to Beatles fandom in 2021. The young children or younger people who are getting onto the Beatles for the first time, are they listening to albums? Do you think they're experiencing the albums as albums, or do you think they're experiencing this song, this song, this song?
Well, I can answer that a little bit.
Yeah, please do.
I had a young gentleman on by the name of Jason Malaberti, and we did a YouTube video together. And he's got a podcast called Rock Bands Podcast. And he's basically a classic rock fan. And there's a pretty strong segment of people, young people, he's about 25, who are big classic rock fans. Sort of into the Zeppelin, the Pink Floyd, and they do listen to the albums. They're much more historical. They want to listen, experience the album all the way through. They're buying vinyl. But there's another contingent of people that seem to be buying the downloads. And we know that Here Comes the Sun is the most downloaded Beatles song, which kind of surprised me. Well, maybe not. But somebody's downloading those, and they're finding them somehow. And all the different ways of YouTube, and obviously the Beatles had anniversary things come out, Sgt. Pepper 50th anniversary, all that stuff. So the Beatles still kind of remain in the news. McCartney's got something new out, Ringo. So that helps.
Yeah, that's a good point. The anniversary stuff, I'm sure there are some people who have gotten into the albums more specifically through that. Than they otherwise would have, just sort of randomly streamed things. And while we're on that subject, let me throw out a random shout out. I only just discovered this channel a week or two ago. It's called Call Me Caroline. And she has started doing reaction videos. She was originally going to do a reaction to her first listen to the Please Please Me album and her first listen to the last album. But that raises the question, is the last album Abbey Road or Let It Be? You know, which one is she going to choose? But anyway, but then the commenters were like, no, react to them in order. You won't get the Beatles unless you react to each album. So apparently that's what she's doing now. She's done Please Please Me and with the Beatles. But then I was even thinking about that. Okay, so, well, actually she's not American. But if she was, that raises the question, do the American albums exist anymore? Is Meet the Beatles still available in America? I don't know how that works.
You know, they did re-release them. There was a couple of different releases. They did a CD box set of the first four albums, and then did a second one, and then they stopped. And then they came out with an American package of albums on CD. And I don't know if those are, I think you might be able to get those, but they're not the original American mixes, which is what older folks want, because that's what they grew up with. So.
Yeah. Wow. See, again, there's things like that that really change your perspective on the music and on the band. I could understand that as an American growing up with those albums, you probably want those albums because they represent your earliest memories of the Beatles, but they don't really exist anymore, or at least not, they're harder to find. I mean, that's an interesting
aspect. Well, the Beatles in the 80s when they came on CD, that was the first time where they standardize the releases, and that's pretty much how they want to keep it. But I mean, the Americans and Canadians and those of us who've had those fake stereo versions, those are still in our head, and good luck getting those out of our heads, you know. So you gotta serve us.
Yeah, for my perspective, I never knew that the version of If I Fell with the double tractor stereo intro vocals, I didn't know that existed. I had never heard it before. So I know this song. I love this song. One of my favorite songs. I've listened to it a million times. And then I for some reason, I was on YouTube and I was clicking on, oh, I'll listen to it on YouTube. And suddenly there's this double track intro. And I'm like, what is this? It sounds so different. It sounds so weird and wrong to me. But there are people who grew up with that. And that's the version of the song they know.
Mm-hmm.
Crazy.
You know, as regards to album order, that's an interesting question. I would say if you look at the generation gap back then and the generation gap today, it's a very different gap. The generation gap back then was a chasm it was huge. I mean, you know, you could see that in the film footage, the reels, everything like that, from the parents, most of the parents' reactions to what was going on, especially the establishment cops and people like that. But, you know, you have today, and the first of all, the kids have the same access to music that we do, right? In other words, they could go back and iTunes and get anything they want, right? And I'm sure the trend for a long, long time was to do random play on stuff. But I think a lot of the sharper younger kids I know, even personally, say, I won't say kids, but they're in their early 20s, you know, they've heard enough from the older generation. No. You have to listen to this record in its order. It's meant to be that way. And these kids will abide by that. They're actually saying, okay, well, maybe they have something there. So I'm going to listen to it like this.
I think the Beatles are particularly amenable to that. I mean, if there's any band where you should be listening to it in the context, it's, I don't know. I guess you can make that argument for a lot of bands, but certainly the Beatles would stand up to that. But actually, I mean, this is the experience I'm going through right now with my children, very young children who are getting essentially the same treatment that I got as a kid when we go out driving around and I'm listening to the Beatles, they're listening to the Beatles. So they are becoming familiar with the Beatles' work. And if I ever ask, you know, what do you want to listen to? They just don't know that many songs. So they'll often say Yellow Submarine or something like that.
Okay. Right.
So they are getting exposed that way. And you make an interesting point about the way that children today have access to the past in a way that we didn't have when we were growing up, instantaneous access to half a century or more of media, just instantly at their fingertips, to the point where there is this sort of, the past isn't so much the past anymore. And here's a weird example of that. My children have recently gotten into the old Smurfs cartoon from the 80s, which even I didn't, I vaguely remember it from my childhood. I never got into, but my kids are super into it now. And it's so bizarre to me. Like, they're into this thing that was a thing when I was a child, but now they're into it. And that's, I think that's probably happening more and more as the entire past gets opened up, which sort of begs the question, you know, where do the Beatles stand in that, and how do they continue to be propagated, and is it reputation based at this point? It's just like, well, this was the biggest band, so you should know about this band, or you know, how do people into that?
I want to have a comment about that. I think that what you said is interesting. How access is so easy now. I think people take it for granted, and I think because it's so easy, I would have to believe they value it less. And I think that's just across the board. I mean, because when I was a kid, I mean, I had to go through record stores. There weren't even books on this stuff. Very few books. And you just had to listen to music. I talked to older people who grew up during the time, and I went through record bins. So when I got my driver's license, I just hit every record store in town. So that's how I did it. And yeah, I think Rick Beato, if you watch his channel at all, he's got his opinion with regard to any band like the Beatles is, if you are a blocker and you do not let people discuss your music from like a theory standpoint, that you will be forgotten. If you do not put your stuff out there, you will be forgotten. So that's his line. And I don't know, time will tell. It'll be interesting to see how this all plays out.
Yeah, but that's a good point, and something that I think very few people would really be able to see. But yeah, absolutely. People who are protecting their intellectual property to the point where they don't want people to play it online. You don't understand how this information is being propagated these days. That's how people are discovering work. And I can attest, people like Beato and others who are talking about albums from 35 years ago or something, you know, when I was... I've never heard it. I didn't know, but I will go out and buy the album because they go through and show me why it is worth listening to. So again, it's just part of that tectonic shift that's taken place in the past couple of decades.
Also, you know, again, there are categories of fans. I mean, now I'm looking at today you get the people who are turned on to the Beatles, but they're not themselves artists or musicians. All right. And I live in an artistic community. It's a totally bohemian community here. So I know plenty of young musicians. And I think the difference there is to the untrained non-musician, the Beatles is just more information. It's just another, you know, flow of data. More or less. I mean, they might appreciate them, whatever, but it's not as important as it was to say my generation when I was growing up. But what I'm also finding is that the young musicians who do appreciate the Beatles and really understand why they're great, they're almost like a quality fan, like a high quality Beatles fan. You know, that's what I've been seeing, you know. Interesting. I was, you know, I busk out in Venice. I, if you don't know what busking means, it's performing live in the streets. And I met a 25-year-old guy, and he starts talking to me about all this like classic old rock and roll. He's just completely going through it. And I said, I had to ask him his age. I'm like, dude, how old are you? He goes, I'm 25, you know. And I said, how is it that you are interested in all this? And it was kind of similar. He said, you know, my parents were into it. My dad showed me all this music, and I eventually realized, hey, this is good.
Yeah. Well, I guess I can almost speak as someone on kind of both sides of that coin, because obviously, I mean, growing up, I never had any musical training per se. So I had a completely untrained ear that was listening to it. And now, as you know, I'm studying music theory and with you and songwriting and all of that. So I am experiencing the other side of it and getting into the theory of the Beatles and why their songs were so incredibly amazing. But I almost think it's more about inclination or some sort of, there's an ability to appreciate, even to an untrained ear, there is an ability that you pick up on certain things about, you know, songwriting or something just by listening that, oh, you know, they did that thing where most bands, I think, would have done that. Oh, that's interesting. You pick up on certain things like that, even if you're not necessarily trained on why that's working.
Oh, absolutely. And I don't mean to come off snobby when I say untrained. You're totally right. And in fact, what was that podcast again? You mentioned Carolyn.
Call Me Caroline.
Call Me Caroline. Yeah, she'd listen to this one chord change and go, oh, that was a surprise, you know. And I think that does happen in the listener's ear, like, well, I wasn't expecting that. You know, especially with a lot of contemporary pop music where the same four chords cycle over and over again and there's not much going on that way.
Right.
Harmony.
I mean, obviously we're biased, but I would like to think that there is something objective there in the sense that at the very least, yes, the novelty and the surprise and the sort of innovation of what they were doing is pretty undeniable within the context of Western popular music or whatever, blah, blah, blah. But within that context, it seems pretty objective that clearly there was something going on here. And if you put it in that context, I don't think it would be possible to deny that, right?
Well, I think there's a beauty in the melodies because the Beatles were first and foremost songwriters and song crafters, and they crafted songs like nobody else. So there's a frequency that people, I think, pick up on. Not everybody does, but there's something about them of how they wrote and the sound that they created together that just touches more people. I don't know what, if there's an objective part in there, I gotta find it, but something, my intuition tells me that there is, and that's why I've been gravitating, that's why I found you guys. I'm gravitating a little bit more toward the theory, because when I hear you guys or Beato or whomever, they're explaining it in a way that is really valuable. But I'm like, wow, that's, if somebody, a theorist says, well, this is special or this is important because of this, and they probably, because they didn't know how to read music and they came up with this, how do they do that? That's innate. That's their own abilities of just doing it naturally. So that natural talent is being channeled into something very special. So I really have been enjoying the theory part of it, even though I'm kind of an amateur musician. I mess around. I've got some formal training, but I know enough to be dangerous. But I think some other people that don't have any training at all, they pick up on that frequency as well.
Yeah, yeah, I think so. Maybe my experience is similar to yours, because I found Vinny, because I was just interested. I was looking online for music theory kind of stuff related to the Beatles. And that's how I found Vinny. And once I found his videos, I was just like, wow, like, finally, someone who's really digging into this. This is really cool.
Hey, anybody you could talk for an hour on I'm the Walrus, I'm in.
Yeah. half of those videos too, man. I could have gone on for another 45 minutes, I think. Yeah. You know.
We actually try to keep it under an hour, but
you know how that all evolved was simply like, you know, I've been a teacher for a long while and I'm a big music theory nerd. And when I was trying to get a concept across to a student, I'd say to them, you know, this, you could find just about any music theory concept in some Beatles song or another. And that's how the whole ball started rolling. One student finally asked me, well, would you start making videos? I'll come here. And instead of the lesson, I'll video for an hour talking about different Beatles songs. That's how that all started.
It was a good thing that it did. All right, if we're looking at fandom and approaches to the Beatles and how people access the Beatles and how they react to it, let's pick up on what you mentioned earlier, Vinny, which was anti-fandom, which is a great way of framing it. And in the early days, yeah, it was, you know, the older generation looking down their nose at these mop tops and what have you. But I have experienced the younger version of that anti-fandom,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
The post-Beatles anti-fandom.
A different anti-fandom from the early anti-fandom.
Exactly, right? I mean, yeah, there's different totally eras. Different, yeah. But it's interesting because the Beatles have become the totem of, you know, pop culture and the 1960s and, you know, the 20th century music phenomenon and all of these things. They become this such an iconic thing that I understand. I can understand the reaction against that. And in fact, yeah, let me tell this story. So I've been an English major and that was what I was interested in growing up. So I did my my undergrad in English literature. I did my master's degree in Anglo-Irish literature, and I was always proud of the fact that I'd never seen or read Hamlet, which is not something you should probably be even admitting, let alone bragging about. But I was like, you know, either it is truly the greatest thing ever written in the English language, in which case I don't want to know it because I don't want to be influenced by that, or it's not so great as it's been cracked up to be, in which case I'll seem really cool and avant-garde. But there's you know, there are like G.B. Shaw and others who have put down Shakespeare and said, oh, he's overrated and his reputation will go down and that kind of thing. In a way, it seems to me that there is that aspect of hipsterish anti-fandom in our era. It's like, oh, the Beatles overrated. Oh, you know, the Stones did better or whatever. You know, the contrarian position, I think, definitely exists. And it rankles, but I at least understand where it's coming from.
Yeah, I've never seen too much anti-Beatle sentiment. A little bit, what I hear now is this, there's contingents of people that want to dig at the Beatles because just to be at the contrary, and the thing I hear now is they were the first boy band. And the implication there is they were completely manufactured, which is absolute horseshit. And they'll go off on this thing they don't know what they're talking about. So that's how they spew their dislike for the Beatles. They try to start shit. And that's to be expected. You hear that in different parts of the Beatles story that, you know, everybody has got a little something they got to bug up their behind about. And they just run with it. So that's always happening on the outskirts of these more serious discussions. And I don't ever hear musicians that ever say that they don't like the Beatles or the Beatles weren't good. That's, Vinny, have you ever run across that much? I never really have. They're revered. They're still very revered across all the generations of fans that I'm aware of, the musicians I'm talking about.
You know, it's kind of like when you think about Miles Davis, if you're a musician, you can't say, I don't like Miles Davis. You can't amongst musician friends because they'll look at you like you're from another planet. I think of my band, The Blue Kind, great, great, great band. And we write in a similar way that the Beatles did. We kind of group write. We get together in a studio and like, I have this chord progression. What can we do with it? And we eventually fashion a song. It's a great band. They know how much I adore the Beatles and they will acknowledge that, but they would never, they much more highly esteem like Steely Dan, which is more jazz oriented, you know. And I can tell. There's a difference between a diehard, passionate, dyed-in-the-wool Beatles fan and somebody who knows they're supposed to appreciate them. You know?
You know, so my experience, I can assure you there are people with the attitude I was describing, but maybe not. I tend to think when I hear that, those are not musicians or people who have ever attempted music. I tend to think those are the people who, I just have a certain image of hipsters who get all of their musical opinions from Pitchfork and, you know, you've heard of this band? It has more than 100 fans. It can't be any good. That kind of hipster attitude, which taken to its extreme, you deny the Beatles.
I'm having a memory come up. I just thought of a guy who doesn't like the Beatles. And this guy, first of all, before we even discussed Beatles, we were hanging out having drinks. And he tells me he's a DJ, but he used to be a jazz pianist. And I said, why did you give up being a musician? And I said it really in a snide way, because I have this thing about DJs, you know. And then he went on to defend to the hilt why being a DJ is the same as being a musician and blah, 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 blah. And I eventually brought up the Beatles, and he just has no regard for the Beatles. He doesn't like them. He thinks they're not good.
Well, if I could interject this example and the one prior, this is what's called the jazz effect. So most people, like Steely Dan for one, I love Steely Dan. And those two guys, they do not mention the Beatles at all, because they are jazz guys and blues, but there's a certain air that jazz players take on where they won't give the credit to the Beatles, which I'm not really, I don't have that big of a problem with it, because jazz music is just different. It's a different beast altogether. And there is a level that isn't for everybody. Whether you want to call that a higher level or not, I'm not sure I want to call it that, but let's call it that. But yeah, they don't want to give the Beatles credit. Now, I know damn well Steely Dan benefited from the Beatles. They don't want, but they won't say it. Well, Becker can't say it now.
That's a great point. But that, you know, that comes from more Steely Dan. They were embarrassed of their early records because they were trying to be jazz musicians, right? And they eventually honed their craft to, they became somewhat jazz composers, you know. But that reflects insecurity, if anything. It's basically like, if you know as a jazz musician, if you know for sure, if you're confident and solid, that you know what the hell you're doing and you know you can be brilliant, right? You would have no reservations of saying, yeah, I love the Beatles. There have been plenty of jazz renditions of Beatles songs. Bill Frisell did a beautiful Beatles concert. Ella Fitzgerald did a Beatles record. I love her version of Savoy Brown. You got to check it out. I just love it.
I don't use. Yeah, like I have. I have ones. Blue Beat, the music of Lennon and McCartney, and it's got Stanley Turrentine, Can't Buy Me Love, Stanley Jordan, Eleanor Rigby, Grant Green, I Want to Hold Your Hand, Lee Morgan, Yesterday. But it's funny. Some of these renditions, I think you can tell they didn't get it.
They didn't get
the song. They didn't get what they were doing. They're just like, oh, this is popular. I guess we'll cover it and get some. But there are some of those renditions where you're like, I don't think they understand what this is about. Even.
My prime example of that is, and it really pisses me off because I adore Aretha Franklin. I adore her, but she destroyed Eleanor Rigby. She made a nightmare out of that song, and it pisses me off.
I don't think I've heard
so
hers.
Much. Oh, it's disgusting. It's
I'll have to listen to it.
There is no hint. The only thing that's the same is the lyric. There's the melody isn't there anymore. It became this like soul groove thing, and it just didn't work.
You know, getting back to Steely Dan real quick, you had said that they're embarrassed of their earlier work. Why, I don't know, because I love Can't Buy a Thrill just as much as Asia. And their very first single that preceded the first album is called Dallas. If you get a chance, listen to it on YouTube. I love that song. They would not even put it on their box set. They would not even acknowledge it. And here's another thing about Steely Dan. They were touring about 10 years ago on the albums Asia and Royal Scam. And they played those all the way through. When the song The Fez came up, Becker and Fagen walked off the stage and they kind of went like this, like in disgust of the song, and let the musicians play it as an instrumental. So I don't understand why they do that to their own music, but that shows an insecurity that can only come from jazzers. doesn't come from rock. They're like, whatever, you know? So that's, there's a difference between how they view even their own past.
You know, I mean, if we slide into the whole jazz conversation for a moment, at least, I have a buddy, Matt. He's a tenor player, dear friend, great, great player. Every note he plays is just beautiful. He just knows how to make melodies happen. And he refers to jazz Nazis, all right? And the example he gives it, well, you know, you can't play giant steps in all 12 different keys, you know. It's like the intellectual Olympics, you know. But there are other jazz musicians, I'll cite, well, Matt is one of them, but also, and I'm really lucky to have worked and still work with one of the greatest jazz pianists in Los Angeles right now, Rob Mullins. And Rob, all right, he wasn't a Beatles fan. I mean, he appreciated the Beatles. I know he loves them, but Rob is just at home playing a song by the Doors as he is by playing a Miles Davis tune or whatever, you know.
Cool.
So there's that kind of jazz musician.
There,
you know?
There can be reverse snobbery and sort of the flip side of that insecurity too, because that's the way I've always read John's avowed hatred of jazz. You know, where he said, whatever, the blues is a chair and you sit on it, but jazz is whatever he called it. I don't know what exact words he used, but he really hated jazz. And I don't know, I've always read that as a kind of insecurity on his part or against the snobbery of jazz.
Was that John Lennon that you were saying?
Yeah.
Well, I do know the reason, part of the reason was in the Beatles' very formative years, jazz was something that people wanted jazz clubs to play, and they were trying to play rock music in jazz clubs.
Right.
So yeah. The Beatles, the one thing that I've learned about the Beatles, they are great grudge carriers. And that's one of the reasons they had a problem with jazz. But I think they loosened up as years went on.
Yeah. Well, so if we've broached the topic of anti-fandom, let's broach the topic of the hour, the year. Because we're in 2021, and of course, you know, cancel culture and everything is getting off. And all sorts of things from the past, all sorts of totems and statues are being torn down. The Beatles, will they be torn down because of their past? Specifically, of course, John Lennon.
John Lennon, he was a wife beater.
Yeah.
Therefore, have you all heard? Of his music sucks, you know.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that's really the way it goes. It just takes one thing and everything is bunk, you know. And that could happen. I mean, I'm more concerned, I guess, will we be able to continue doing stuff like this? Because I think people like us that are on the YouTube, whoever is able to freely promote anything on any media, if that's taken away, everybody's canceled. So far as there's a free flow of information, there's enough of us people now, we've got roughly three generations here. If we create enough content that's good enough that can sit around and last, that'll have some legs for a while until the next group can come and build on that. So I think we're just at the mercy of the medium if it's allowed to operate.
You know, that is such a good point, because it is a structural issue, isn't it? Because who cares if there are people out there that don't like John Lennon because of what he did, or okay, great. And maybe they can start some movement and whatever, but that has no teeth to it unless it has an effect on the way that people can disseminate and appreciate and enjoy and share and spread information and music freely. But once they start, that's why the cancel culture is always attacking, trying to get these people so that you can't buy their work, you can't see them again, they're essentially erased from history. And yeah, that's, I think, the real scare of this. Again, of course, people can have whatever opinions they want, and they can raise, I think, valid points about history and about the types of people in history, and we shouldn't be putting people on pedestals and blah blah blah. Sure, but let's have that open conversation openly, not behind a screen of censorship. Speaking of which, just as a side note, my backup YouTube channel was just censored yesterday. So I am completely 100% off YouTube, except when you post me to your channel, Vinny.
How does it feel?
Relieving, to be honest.
I thought so.
but it does obviously raise the specter. And obviously it's because I'm talking about politics and that kind of, you know, sensitive matter. But it's coming for every aspect of our lives. And you're right to bring that up, Matt. I think this is a structural issue.
This is, yeah, it's actually frightening. The whole trend of knocking down statues from the past and kind of trying to destroy, you know, the history of America and all this stuff. And the thing about it is, when you go back to the era of the Beatles, it was incredibly, unbearably politically incorrect. I can't help but think of that scene in the series Mad Men, where they're having a picnic and they finished all the food and they're out in a park, you know, this beautiful park, and they finished all the food and they lifted the blanket, left all the junk there and walked away. That was the mentality back then. It really was.
You know, on that note, even in the anthology, they kept a bit of it in. John Lennon doing his spastic routine on stage, right? You could see a bit of that in the anthology. But by the time Ron Howard did 8 days a week, they cut away. They cut that out. It was visibly like they had to cut away from it very awkwardly at times because he was about to go into his spastic routine, which obviously, I mean, that's the kind of stuff would get you canceled very quickly today, right?
Well, what's interesting, Anthony, is I believe Ringo Starr actually addressed him doing that, reasons why he did it. It might be in the book and maybe not the film. But I thought that is interesting as well, because John Lennon was a complex character and had a difficult upbringing that, and demons that I think he never quite was able to exercise. And so I think that plays in. And the idea that we use today's standards to put on past eras is just, I think that's just, that's not a reason to cancel. It was, if it was accepted then, you know, you go back 300 years, well, things were accepted then where you don't accept now, but it's just, you can still talk about it. You can still show it. It can still be said in a history book, but obviously we're in some very strange times.
Well, you know, cancel culture, now that I'm thinking of it, is a reflection of this same kind of insecurity we've been talking about, because if your philosophical, moralistic model is so secure, then why are you worried about the you know, ghosts of the past haunting you and destroying the edifice you've built up? You know, there's a saying I have, you can't legislate morality. You can't legislate morality. And that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to say, you do this. That's great on the external. Inside, if you're a psycho killer, you know, it doesn't matter how you mold your exterior behavior. You know, that's the way I see it. You can't legislate that into people. People have to come up with their true own ethics. And we live in such an empty society that that's not going to happen anytime soon.
Yeah, agreed. But I guess the question is, what then are the prospects for continuation of Beatles fandom under the looming threat, you know, of this type of, I mean, what even our role as content creators, do we focus in on this? Do we talk about it? Do we address these types of criticisms? Do we ignore them? What should our role be in this?
I mean, that you platforms like YouTube will still exist, assuming that this will be around. I think what you're going to find are content creators that mention it and those that don't. And the ones that don't, can you can go wherever you want, because I'm going to mention it and I don't have a horse in the race. I'm not the one doing it. It's a historical record. And you can have a dialogue around it that isn't just a canceled type of dialogue or making fun of disabled people or whatever. So I think there's going to be two versions, or maybe three. Right now we have that now. You were mentioning these Once We Dream, these podcasts that are tailored to fit a bias or narrative. I'm trying to obliterate those with mine. So mine, I've got a narrative of my own.
Well, to be fair, they frame it that they are obliterating the biases and narratives. So of course everyone has that perspective.
Well, I think, I mean, there's a way to balance it and keep it open, I guess, is really the way. Like Mark Lewison said, his book is not the final answer. This is the beginning. So if you take that perspective, like I'll do a video and there's things I leave out, things wind up on the cutting room floor, things I'll get wrong. Those things can be corrected. and we can do another one. You know, it goes on. And I get a lot of great feedback from people that watch me. That's really, if you can take the best from your feedback and push that back out, that's really how it grows. So that to me is, I think, how I see what I'm doing is going to grow. If I'm going to contribute to either the Beatle conversation, 60s music, or what have you, that's how it's going to grow. It's not going to be, it's me putting it out there. It's everybody else picking it up and running with it.
You know what?
I'm going to pose a question to the both of you.
Sorry. I was just going to remark, as since you brought up Lewison and sort of, you know, it's just the beginning. It's not the be all and end all. But one impression that I got from reading Lewison was, oh yeah, I don't think I would have liked any of these people as human beings individually, like as friends. I don't think I would have been friends with any of them, but that's fine. Do I have to be? Like, does it have to be like I would be personal friends with these people? That's ridiculous. No, the art is greater than the artist.
Always, yeah, yeah.
And that's quite a privilege for us to have. You know, we have all this wonderful music to listen to and talk about and study and talk about a first world problem. You know, it's really a blessing to be able to do this. And there's a humility about it, I think, as well, that goes along with this wonderful music we're talking about.
Well, insofar as how the Beatles are projected into the future, I have great faith in the Beatles and the energy behind the Beatles. I want to pose a question to you guys. If you can encapsulate in one word the Beatles philosophy, what word would say it?
Matt?
Well, I'll let you go first. The first thing that came to my mind was not their philosophy, but how I rate them or how I would describe them. And it has to do with a very high level of joy. So I don't know what they were trying to say. I think they were just trying to have fun and have hits and get rich, and which is a lot of us try to do. And there's joy along the path. And they had to pay a lot of prices with that big fame, but we get the joy.
I'm so glad you said that, actually, because that is the exact word that occurred to me. I don't know what their philosophy was, but that is the essence, I think, of the Beatles, is joy. And I was thinking recently, if I had to just one little musical passage that just encapsulated what the Beatles are to me, I was thinking it's the buildup of the harmonies in the middle of Twist and Shout, where they start building up and then that scream erupts and then it just goes. I think if you do not feel, viscerally experience the joy, the pure, unbridled joy of that moment, then you don't get the Beatles and you're probably not human.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, the word that was like the way I see, if people looking back on the Beatles now and in the future, what was the Beatles' message? You know, Ringo's always flashing the peace sign, peace and love, peace and love. The Beatles' message was basically love from the beginning to the end, you know, and in the end, the love you take, you know. So my word is, I'm totally on board with the joy factor. And I always tell people, listen, I know that it's cool to like the later era Beatles, but listen to the early stuff and just listen to the energy behind it. Just feel that energy. You know, it's bristling.
Oh, and the first album I ever listened to was Introducing the Beatles, basically the first album. And I still marvel at the energy and how great that record sounds to me today. Just absolutely wonderful.
Yeah, I think the Beatles' message was love. I think that's what cut through the whole time. And I think that may carry into the future in spite of all the sociological, you shouldn't have done that stuff that especially Lennon participated in, you know, from the we're bigger than Jesus to the...
Well, that's a part of what the Beatles were. I mean, you have to take it. So yeah, my long-term perspective, I agree. I have faith. I think they've survived 50 years. I'm sure they could survive another 50. It has proven it cuts across generations. It cuts across time, temporal contexts. It has staying power. The real question is Apple and how they handle the catalog and whether they allow it to proliferate in online spaces and in new ways, or whether they try to clamp down on it. So they really could, I suppose, squelch the entire thing in the crib if they wanted to, but it would be difficult.
I'm a little more pessimistic. I'm slightly more pessimistic because it'll be interesting to see how all this era, when the baby boomers leave us, where there's going to be a big, all these albums behind me, a lot of people, they're going to wind up in landfills because there's going to be so much of it that a lot of younger people just won't want to deal with. They won't value it. So I'm not sure. Like the past 20 years, I think the biggest selling Beatle album is The Beatles One. So it's like 21 greatest hits, essentially. So I think that the hits are going to be the ones that are remembered the most. And whether the albums get played a lot, I think will depend on people like us to continue to show the value. Because like if you go back to Bach or Mozart or any of those, I mean, we basically hear their greatest hits. And I think that's okay. For all the classical lovers, we can delve in deeper.
Yeah, but I can see that. In a few hundred years, if they're listening to the Beatles' greatest hits, I guess I'd be happy with that. You know, good enough.
I'll take it.
Aside from that, you know, the greatest hits, like if you look at Mozart or Bach, you know, the greatest hits are the gateway drug in. In other words, if you get so moved by Bach, which I have personally been, you know, and Mozart, you want to find more after that, you know. And the Beatles have that. They have that thing where it's like, wow, if this was so good, it's like what happened to you, James, in a way, you know. Wow, if this is so good, I wonder what this other stuff must be like. Let me go check it out. So there's that possibility. As long as the catalog is accessible, then, you know, it's possible. And I don't know, maybe there'll be younger people like me. I could probably play almost every Beatles song by heart, you know. And if the records don't exist, the musicians that can play those songs will.
Well, before we started rolling, we mentioned Anthony Rotuno, so let's give him a shout out. He can play an awful lot of them, and he does on his podcast as well. So good on him.
Yes, he does. Yeah, and Vinny, I think that anybody who approaches the Beatles from a musical theory point and brings out some of the nuances of their music, I think that's just so valuable. I mean, I'm learning so much from that. That adds to the joy. So I think that doing that also helps make them live longer, because musically, some people will, you know, it's 300 years from now, would their early stuff even be considered, who knows what it'll be considered like. Maybe jazz will be popular then, finally. I don't know. But I think obviously there's great value in their work. So hopefully, and there's so many different levels of that. The more you dig into their story, the more rich it becomes. So I think as long as people appreciate history, I think the Beatles story is like, as I think Lewison called it, the central story of the 20th century. So wow. That's going to take a long time to vanish, I think.
Yeah. And by the way, I just wanted to throw this out to you, especially Matt, because of your research into the 60s, I don't think the Beatles were, I think the Beatles were one third of the pie. There were three slices to the pie. The Beatles are one, and bringing in the British invasion. Then if you ever get a chance to see Greenwich Village, the music that changed a generation, see that documentary. This is like New York folkies, and it was interesting what was going on with the folkies. In a way, it's what's happening with younger people nowadays. For example, I saw a country band the other day playing Maggie's Farm by Bob Dylan. It blew me away. These like 20 somethings, you know. But the other piece of the pie, all right, so in Greenwich Village, the tradition before Dylan arrived was to rehash these old folk tunes, and it was considered like an intellectual thing, you know, a very New York intellectual type thing. And then when Dylan came along, he was like frickin' Saint John of the desert. And there's a moment in this documentary where he's singing Hard Rain in a cafe and chills. It's like chills go up and down your spine. That brought in the folk rock element. So then you get bands like the Mamas and the Papas, who were considered more folk, but also heavily influenced by the British invasion and especially the Beatles, right? So there's that piece of the pie. And the third piece is Motown and the Black music of America. All of those three comprise the incredible blossoming of music that was the 60s and into the 70s.
I totally agree. Yeah, I agree with you completely. And there's such a rich history in all three of those.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm telling you, I can't wait to do videos on all those bands. You know, it's going to be so fun.
Wait till I get you and Vinny talking about the early 90s. It'll be great. You don't understand Siamese Dream, man. All right. Well, I think we'll leave it there. There's so much. We could do an entire conversation just on like American fandom versus British fandom and that kind of stuff. But
you bet. Yeah.
Anyway, I guess we'll leave it there for today, right?
All right. Yeah, let's do that. Thanks, everybody, for watching. Thanks for dropping by, James. Matt, thanks for dropping by. And let's do this again sometime.
For sure. I'd be happy to.
All right. Great. All right. Well, take care then.